Welcome to EPG Pathsala. I am Dr. S. G. Vanandam, teaching history in the Department of History from Sikkim University. Today, we are going to see very interesting topic, Devadasi, the dancing girls, as a part of this subject, women's studies. If you see the Indian history, it's very, very unique and very, very complex in its nature. In general, the recorded history, it's about talking about the achievements of the male member of the society. But in the practical sense, the women were a very, very important cultural element of the society, were very, very nominal in its recorded history. So if you look at the historical documents, the women were very, very marginal in any sense. Very few women were highlighted in history, and also there were three different categories of women were recorded in the historical records. For example, royal women and prostitute women, and also some other women, one who have certain kind of exemptions. If you say, for the sake of royal women, Razia Sultana and Mangayar Karsi from South India and Rani Lakshmibai, very, very few women were considered are recorded in the history. On the other hand, in the case of prostitute, though it is considered as one of the important social cultural element of the human history, but in none of the recorded history talks about the prostitution and the role of women in it. The third category, the exemptions, is something different. Some very few women, for example Andal, for Mirabai, and few women were recorded. However, the history tells something different to us. For example, Devadasi were one of the important social category, could explain the role of women in the ancient and medieval and even modern society. Devadasi is believed to be a woman who had been enslaved to do services to a deity or sacred object which attached or installed to any Brahminical temples. The term is to be a Sanskritized form of the Tamil word Devaradiyar, which means a woman who enslaved for the service of some deity or sacred object. According to the tradition, Devadasi was ritually got married to the temple deities which they were young, and the rite of such marriages resembled the Brahminical marriage ceremonies. Her primary social identity is identified with the reference to any temple. It was a common feature in almost all major Brahminical temples in India. Devadasi, in generally, they do the divine marriages of the temple girls, were eternally free from the so-called inauspicious widowhood. In this context, Sasika Kersenboom's story, a ethnographer referred Devadasi as Nitya Sumangali. Lesivo, a historian, stated that Devadasi, or a temple woman, was a woman one who may or may not be a prostitute or a dancer, and one who is associated with temple either by having some kind of regular services in function in a temple, or because her primary social identity is defined with a reference to any temple. Frederick Affel Moglen, a anthropologist, considered Devadasis as a very specialized, unusual group of women, and one who acted as harbingers of auspiciousness to a state and a society. Edgar Thursden, an ethnographer of the colonial period, described Devadasis as a dasis or a devadasis, or dancing girls attached to the temples who subsist by dancing and music and the practice of the oldest profession in the world. This is or the largest sense or the definition about the Devadasi women. Devadasi system, it's a pan-Indian phenomena. The system has existed in throughout different parts of India like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Assam, Andhra Pradesh, Orissa, and in rest of India. The system was known by different names in different regions. For example, in Assam, the system was called as Kurumbus or Kutipus. In the same case, in Karnataka, the system was known as Sulayar, Sule, Poti, Pasavi or Jogatis. In Odisha, the system was called as Tarigas or Patras and Maharis. Maharashtra, the Devadasis were known as Pahavin and Kalavant. In Andhra Pradesh, the system Devadasis were known as Sanis and Boham. In Kerala, Devadasis were known by different names such as Tevidichi, Nangaimar, Kudikari, Muraikari, Kutachi, Kutichi, Teyanna and Atakari. In Tamil Nadu, the system known as the people one who practice are known as Devadasi, Devaradiyar, Padilar, Talicheri Pendugal, Devanar Mahal, Adigalmar, Manikam, Emberuman Adigar, Koil Pillaimar and Koil Pinakal. So, the system it's widespread throughout the Indian range. Caste is one of the important social elements, social category in Indian subcontinent. With regarding caste and the question of Devadasi was correlated and is one of the highly important question in the social and cultural history of India. The question of caste was associated with Devadasi system, but however, Devadasi system is not identified as a separate caste at all. Kirsten Boom, I already mentioned her name in the earlier discussion also, pointed out that nature of Devadasihood is Murai or Vidhi, which means functions or task, not as Jati, she referred. Devadasi could accumulate girls from different castes, customs and regions. They could dedicate to different deities. Based on their caste affiliations, the division of labor and hierarchy was set. So, Devadasi system is not a separate caste, but caste played a vital role in it. The dedicated girls from upper caste were allowed to perform ritual roles and others had only the secular. Later part of this discussion, we will explain about the what is their ritualistic and non-ritualistic roles. In some time, the upper caste girls were taken by the upper caste men as a concubines and others went as a commercial prostitutes. Caste is one of the important cultural category in the Indian history. Without caste, to understand Indian society, it's a little bit complex. So, and however, with Devadasi institution also, caste is one of the overlapping category. Many often the historians and anthropologists and even ethnographers confused the category called Devadasi and caste system as a unique or otherwise same. But history tells something different. Devadasi system is not considered as a separate caste. They were part of the caste system and Devadasi system could accommodate different women from different sections of the society. So, caste played a vital role in the Devadasi institutions. Based on their caste, they are getting their social significance. For example, upper caste women like a Brahmin, they get a little bit a ritual status than the lower section of the society. The lower section of the society, they meant for the non-ritualistic performance like cleaning plates, vessels and also washing clothes and all the things. The historical development of Devadasi system. There are many speculations and theories which regarding the origin of Devadasi system. The theories such as occupation and mother goddesses theory, religious tradition theory, Sanskritization theory, radical theory, matriarchy to patriarchy theory, lineage continuation theory and traditional theory are few of could explain about the genesis of Devadasi system. The system of dedicating women for ritual service was an ancient and universal practices. The practices was existed in the regions like Mesopotamia,
Egypt, Greece, Babylonia, Cyprus, and other ancient countries. The development of the Devadasi institution was not uniform in its nature. The service of women in the temples in India was an innovation of the Puranic religion. The practice of worship in public temples was taking shape in the early centuries of the Common Era. The custom was much practiced and prevailed from the early medieval period onwards. The expansion of the temple system and the growth of Bhakti movement brought into existence the class of temple dancing girls. The inscriptions also revealed that the 11th century and the 12th century are marked as the period of its maximum growth. The existence of the Devadasi institution does not go back to the 3rd century BCE because the practice of worship in the public temples was taking shape in the early centuries of the Common Era. Leslie Orr suggested that the system is prevailed from the early medieval period onwards. M.G.S. Narayanan, a prominent South Indian historian, believed that the expression of the temple system and the growth of the Bhakti movement brought into existence the class of temple dancing girls. The Devadasi custom had to become an institution towards an end of the 5th century to 6th century under the patronage of Pallavas and Pandyas. In Tamilagam, the earliest inscription which mentioned about the Devadasis is as late as 8th century. The early literary sources which mentioned about the association of Devadasi with the temples is in the hymns of Tamil Nayanmar Chammandar in 7th century. The Devadasi institution was established in regions that were economically and politically well developed in the riverine of the Kaveri Delta in Tamilagam. In North India, it neither emerged as an institution having strong base in the society nor a common future of majority of the temples. The political instability of the northern India and the strong non-Hindu rulers such as Persian and Mughals did not patronage the temples and confused to understand the alien practices. Devadasi system in the later medieval period. The symptoms of the decline of the Devadasi institution made their explicit appearance during the Nayaka period between 1565 to 1800. The later medieval records reflected the transcendent conditions of the Devadasi women. The later medieval records such as travelogues, hagiographies and other literary records highlighted the loose characters of the Devadasi. In generally, the decline of Devadasi was associated with the decline of Cholas and Pandyas. The political instability made the struggle for existence of the Devadasi system. Due to the loss of patronage, many professional communities remained unemployed and the workmen suffered from want and misery. The emergence of the Vijayanagar rule in South India marked the significant move in the reformulation of the system. Kumara Kambana, the army chief of Vijayanagara, restored the Devadasi institution from its decline, the privilege of Devadasi women. Generally, Devadasi women had a certain privilege compared than the other women in the history. Devadasi women became an insignificant officiating dignitaries of the temple rituals. They were the most important ritual performers and no celebration was completed in the temple without the performance of the temple girls. Hence, the employment of these dancing girls became customary on the part of the temple institution. They had a certain de facto rights in the temple and society too. They were permitted to use their umbrella, flag, palanquin, etc. They allowed to have children and could adopt female children too. Abeduwais, the colonial person, mentioned that Devadasi were only females in India who may learn to read, to sing and to dance. There were no restriction was imposed on their sexual activities. However, the sexual relations to the lower caste men was considered as social stigma. During the funeral, flowers, sandalwood paste and garland of the deity were offered to Devadasi to honor her lifelong servitude. According to the tradition, the funeral procession was halted for some time in front of the temple. The deity was observed a day-long pollution and no puja was conducted on the day. Usually, the funeral pyre was carried from the temple kitchen.
So far, we have discussed about the basic thing about the Devadasi system and the establishment of and the evolution of the Devadasi institution. According to history, the Devadasi institution was established in the later medieval period with this simultaneously the Bhakti movement, which is influenced a lot in the establishment of the Devadasi institution. However, the history tells that the later medieval period, especially the decline of Pandyas and Cholas, leads to the decline of Devadasi institution for a short term. That its arrival of the Vijayanagara Empire in the South India, extreme South India, especially the adventurous efforts of the Kumarakambana, restored the Devadasi system in South India, especially in the Tamil region. And also he started to patronage the different section of the temple's women, and it giving a kind of a breathing space for the Devadasi system in the later medieval period. The dedication of Devadasi women. In generally, Devadasis were dedicated in two broad category, one as voluntary and another as non-voluntary basis. The voluntary dedication was happened due to various reasons such as superstition, carrying tradition, etc. The vow of the parents whom they were sick or other affliction, or when surrounded by troubles and trials, to give one of their daughters to some particular temple. In further, poor, ignorant and superstitious families were generally became the victims of the custom, which were dependent almost entirely on the profit which they gained. Usually, the perilous pregnant women were making vow to dedicate their daughter to the temple service for their safe delivery. The parents were made pledge to dedicate their youngest daughter because of the critical condition of their firstborn son, who was near to death. After the recovery of the son, the parents fulfilled the oath of their dedication of 8-year-old daughter to the temple. Ramachandra Iyer, an assistant collector of Tiruchirappalli, stated that the custom was permitted the dedication of the elder daughter to the goddesses Pasavi. The non-voluntary dedication, otherwise it is called as forced servitude, was also common phenomena. The adoption was a common feature in the Devadasi system. Devadasi were used to purchase girls from outside the family to dedicate to temple to ensure their posthumous reward of a heavenly abode. In general, they purchased girls from the poor caste Hindus. According to the tradition, no one had a right to dedicate themselves to the temple. They were instructed to get the approval from the respective authorities of the temple administration. The introduction of a virgin girl into the family of a dancing girl was sufficient to entitle her to be treated as daughter, and no matter how she was obtained and to what caste she was belonged. The selection of girls for adoption was based on their physical charm, not more than else. In generally, the duties of Devadasi was classified into two. One is ritualistic, the next another one is non-ritualistic basis. The ritualistic performance included dancing, reciting the devotional songs, maintaining or protecting the auspicious or destroying the inauspiciousness in the society or a family, etc. The non-ritualistic performers were attended to different duties in temples such as washing, sweeping,
gardening, sounding bells, fanning the ideals, etc. For their services, Devadasi women get a remuneration in different forms. For example, they get food as a kind of a remuneration. They got some kind of a rights, and also they get tax. They got tax remissions, and also they got land as the kind of a services, and also money. In some places, Devadasis were considered as one of the important gifts to the temple. The notch performance. The history tells that the gradual growth and reformulated performance of the Devadasis in the public area. In the course of time, Devadasis system reformulated in itself. For example, the decline of the temple economy led to the Devadasi to lose their temple patronage, and also Devadasi faced a kind of a economic hardship. Slowly and gradually, Devadasi started to perform in the public places, and their performance was gradually or generally called as notch. During 17th and 18th century, Devadasis were identified for their performing abilities rather than their ritual roles in the sacred area. The boundaries between courtesans and the temple women had become an indistinguishable. It collapsed the homogeneous identity of the Devadasi hood. The Maratha documents did not carry any word such as Devadasi, but we come to know from different other sources the performance of the Devadasi women in the court places. There were several Maratha records refer the performances of Natyam as Abhinayam, Adal, Nadagam, Natyam, Bharatam, Sadir and Kelikai. The official record detailed the participation of the Devadasi in Sadir and Kelikai, which means entertainment performance in the palaces. Few Devadasis were placed in a high order, such as Muthupalani, a prominent Devadasi of the Maratha period. She lived between 1739 to 1790. She was associated with the court of Pratapa Singh, and later she became a concubine of Pratapa Singh. The versatile Muthupalani was expert in Tamil, Sanskrit and Telugu literature. Her semi-autobiographical poems, popularly called as Radhika Santvanam, which means appeasing Radhika, revealed her ancestral lineage and her literary genius. Devadasi system got its kind of a significant impact due to the colonialism. The colonial officials settled their power over the already functioning networks of the state and authority. The changing pattern of the patronage structure in the 18th century brought new lobbies called new elites, and they became new patrons to the powerful religious institutions. And also there are three different questions that was existed during the colonial regime. The first one is morality. The question of morality was one of the important element in the 19th century due to the colonial intervention. And the next another important point is the purification of the Hindu religion. In 19th century, there are many social reform movements existed and started to criticizing about the existing social problems such as sadi, child marriages, widow remarriages and all. In the course of discussion, they consider Devadasi system as one of the kind of a stigma to the society. So they wanted to abolish the Devadasi system to purify or to retain their social status. And another important point is the role of colonial state in the process of civilizing the people. The colonial mind started to think that the Devadasi was considered as one of the immoral social phenomena in the society. They wanted to purify or they wanted to civilize the society. So they considered, so the abolition of Devadasi system is one of their important social agenda. The legal issues. During the 19th century, because of the colonial intervention, there is a serious problem of Devadasi system had a problem in the legal issues. Especially, Devadas has had a problem in inheritance, and also the colonial government had a problem in identifying Devadas institution, or otherwise to place the institution in the larger social setup. So they had a dilemma to how to consider Devadasi, whether as a sacred person or otherwise as a ritual performer or as a prostitute. And the third one is, there is many abolition acts that is established in the princely states, later in the colonial government, that directly questioned the existence of the Devadasi women. Initially, the abolition process was started in the princely states of colonial India. In 1909, Mysore princely state ordered to stop the dedication practices in his presidential area. In March 1914, Pudukottai Samasthanam in Tamil country opinion against the existence of the Devadasi system. In 1926, the Regency of Sethu Lakshmi Bai of Trivangur princely state issued the proclamation to stop the dedication of the girls in the temples. In the 19th century, the colonial intervention made a huge impact on the Devadasi institution. The social reform movements and the revival movement of the 19th century much questioned about the Devadasa system, because the Hindu reformers of the 19th century wanted to revive their institution, that means the religious institution. They wanted to purify. The colonial intervention and also the missionary activities criticized the existence of the Devadasa system. So the Hindu revivalists consider the Devadasa system is a kind of a social stigma, so they wanted to revive the system and also abolish the Devadasi institution. In the later 20th century, the discourse of abolition went into radical position, that was led by the P.V. Ramaswamy, popularly known as Tandai Periyar. In the 20th century, there is a kind significant changes happening in the political and also in the social platform. There were many social movements had a different kind of a radical questions and addressing Devadasi system or questioning the Devadasi system in the different platform. For example, Suyamariyada Iyakam, which mean the self-respect movement, voiced the concern of the marginalized section of the society and questioned the hereditary monopoly of the Brahmins in the caste society. There is a kind of huge difference between the earlier reformers that were in the 19th century and the later reformers like the self-respecters. The later reformers, they advocated for the universal brotherhood. They questioned the Brahminism and therefore anti-Brahminical and also therefore anti-ritualistic society. It gave a much priority to the self-respected life for the common people. The rationalist believed that the liberation of the country was dependent on the women liberation. All this development directly reflected in the question of Devadasi systems. The radicals, who are generally the self-respect people, strongly believed education would liberate the people from their social clutches. Kudiyarasu, the radical newspaper of the self-respect movement, mentioned that the education brought knowledge, culture, discipline, and good character. The self-respect movement was aware that the patriarchy and religion were the prime causes for the continuation of the Devadasi practice and the reason for other problems of women's subordination in the society. The self-respecters were critical towards the various issues such as masculinity, marriage, property rights, purdah, divorce, child marriage, Devadasi system, prostitution, language, and contraceptions. They larger sense, they question the patriarchy and they give the voice for women and they condemn the masculinity in all levels. The self-respecters strongly believe that the abolition of the Devadas system was desirable and important. E.V. Ramaswamy, the founder and ideologue of the self-respect movement, consider the abolition of the Devadas system and child marriage would lead to women empowerment. The rationalists considered Devadas system as a system of professional prostitution rather than a sacred phenomena. The self-respect newspapers such as Kudiyarasu, Purachi, The Revolt gave special attention toward the issue of Devadasi. The self-respecters stressed the importance of the religious reforms in the society. All these efforts led to the abolition of the, or otherwise prohibition of the Devadasi in the different state legislatures. Out of this development, the Bombay princely state and also Madras, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, Goa, the government banned or prohibit the Devadasi system through various acts, for such as the Bombay Prevention of the Dedication of Devadasi Bill in 1934, the Madras Devadasi Prevention of Devadasi Act of 1947, the Karnataka Devadasi Prohibition of Dedication Act of 1982, Andhra Pradesh Devadasi Prohibition and Dedication Act 1989, and Goa's Children's Act 2003. In the largest sense, the decline of Devadasi systems occurred due to different reasons, such as the political instability happened in the 18th century and the decline of temple economy that leads to the poverty, and also the repeated transfer of the Devadasi from one temple to another temple, from one region to another region, and the lacuna of their educations, and the graded hierarchy within the Devadasi institution leads to the abolition or decline of the Devadasi system. The development of the Devadasi system was not uniform in its nature. The political economy of the respective period determined the characteristics of the Devadasi system. Traditionally, Devadasi had a certain rights and privilege, and the colonial intervention influenced the system. The reformers and revivalists placed their arguments in the abolition and regeneration of the custom. The emergence of the self-respect movement helped reformers like Muthulakshmi Reddy to create a consensus against the custom. The revivalist lobby succeeded to re-establish the dance tradition of Devadasis as Bharatanatyam. The life of Devadasi could reflect the issue of Devadasi system too. The development of Devadasi system, it's not uniform in its nature. Each time and each period has its varied development. The political economy of the particular period influenced the Devadasi institution. For example, in the early medieval period, the establishment of the Cholas leads to the emergence of the Devadasi institution, and the prosperous region like Kaveri Delta region and riverine belt helped the economic activities of the temple economy, that leads to the popularization of the Devadasi institution. Later, the decline of the Cholas and Pandyas leads to the questions about the existence of the Devadasi system. Later, the arrival of Vijayanagara into the Tamil region revived the Devadasi tradition, and it gave a kind of a breathing space for the institution. However, the colonial intervention questioned the temple economy, and also the new political the economy questioned the existence of the and also relevance of the Devadasi institution. The 19th century reform movements like the Hindu revivalist, and also the later the 20th century, the reformers like self-respect movement, who radically questioned and they raised the issue on the exploitation of women in the name of religion, leads to the abolition of the Devadasi institution. And later the legislative assemblies started to abolishing Devadasi institution in the different phases. Thank you.